Hi, this is Marjorie Wildcraft, and I am absolutely delighted today to be interviewing, my guest today is David Blume. And David is an amazing person. He's, for 35 years, he's been looking at a solution that we're all very interested in, and an idea of community-supported fuel. Dave has a solution for how we can create our own fuel for cars and generators and other electrical needs out of making alcohol, and it's sustainable, it has a zero carbon footprint, and it's something that is best done on a community or local scale. David was a previous editor for the Mother Earth News, and he has written this book. It's actually six books in one, called Alcohol Can Be a Gas. And in this book he talks about everything from the history of alcohol and how it's been used for a long, long time, long before petroleum options actually, how you actually distill the fuel, how you convert your automobiles to run on the fuel, economics of starting an alcohol fuel business in your community or in your small town or in your network, and a whole wealth of information all about how you would create fuel. This is a wonderful alternative as the prices of petroleum-based fuel are going up and up, not to mention that this is a sustainable alternative. So David, welcome. Thanks so much for being here.
I'm glad to be here, Marjorie.
And one of the first things that comes up with alcohol or ethanol fuel is everybody says it takes more energy to make alcohol or ethanol than it does that you actually get out of it. And you're telling us that's a myth, that that's absolutely not true.
Well, there's two things to say about that. One, whenever you change one form of energy to another, there's always loss. So when you take crude oil and bring it to the United States, 11,000 mile round trip, and then refine it, you lose 20% just to get started. So it's not unusual to not get as much energy out as you have to start with. But with alcohol, we get to cheat the accountants, because alcohol is made from solar energy. Plants go ahead and combine carbon dioxide from the air, water, and sunlight to make starch and sugar. Those are carbohydrates, carbon dioxide, water, sunlight. So when we make alcohol from a carbohydrate, we start off with this huge bank of free solar energy and use a little bit of energy to distill the alcohol fermented from those carbohydrates into fuel that we could use. So the return on energy the return on energy for fossil fuel input can be as high as 15 or 20 to 1, and typically 8 to 1 is normal for chemically raised crops. Fossil fuel raised crops.
Mm-hmm. And so you're talking about distilling fuel on a 10,000 to 150,000 gallon basis, and for reference, an average American right now is using about 1,000 gallons of fuel just for transportation in their car. So you're talking about creating a small-scale system that would serve anywhere from a dozen to a couple of hundred people. And then, of course, if we were more careful with our fuel usages, it could serve a much larger population. And you say this can be done everywhere in the United States, that pretty much everywhere there's going to be some type of material that we could use. I saw that you use everything from corn to fruit, or even using wood, wood products, or basically waste products from farming activities.
And there are crops that grow in every climate. I mean, if you go into the far north, you can find cattails growing around lakes in Minnesota. If you go to the deserts of the southwest, you can find mesquite pods growing wild. You can make it from cactus. You can make it from kudzu in the south. You can make it from so many different things, because plants make starch and sugar very well. I mean, look at sugar beets, look at sorghum for molasses. All these things can be very good energy crops on your own piece of land or in your community. And so it's really practical to make enough alcohol for a few people rather than just one person, because it's efficient with your time. And as we all know, on a homestead, time is the most limited resource.
Absolutely.
More than anything else. If you have food sovereignty, that's great, but energy sovereignty is equally important. Because food is a commodity. How much food are you going to have to trade with somebody to get fuel for an energy need at your place? So it's important to make sure that you, at least on a community level, are producing both. So for instance, let's say you want to process your family's sewage, from your septic system or whatever, in a marsh, which is a standard way of doing it in many places. Well, you could grow an energy crop in that marsh, and even a tenth of an acre of cattails could probably generate enough fuel to power your vehicle for the whole year. And that's just a simple couple of afternoons of hand harvesting the cattails a couple of times a year to have the raw material to make your fuel. There's a lot of starch in cattails.
Right.
And if you're growing potatoes, or if you've got a fruit orchard, and fruit orchards typically yield 20, 30 tons of fruit, you know, once they're 3, 4, 5 years old, the waste products from that, or if there's a surplus because for some reason there isn't a market, all that can go into making fuel. And it's kind of the way of taking your surpluses and making something permanent, storable, and valuable out of them. Because, you know, once fruit's ripe, it's either sold or you got to do something with it.
Quick, yes.
So, you know, what I would say to folks is think beyond your vehicle, because, you know, if things get rough, travel's not going to be your primary thing. It's going to be heating, cooking, lighting. That's your energy
uses.
Well,
I tell you, I know for me that we heat with wood, and a gallon of gasoline to run that chainsaw, yeah, I would easily pay $100 for that. I'd pay $200 or $300 because I know what it's like to go out there with an axe and try and cut the wood I need to heat my home.
Absolutely.
So you know,
it's often calculated when it comes to work on the land. 1 gallon of fuel is equal to 120 person hours of work. So, you know, I love all those people who say, hey, I'm going to double dig my whole 3 acres, you know, and I wish them the best of luck, but I'm putting a gallon or two of fuel in my tractor and doing it in an afternoon. So, you know, that's energy is really important to maintaining a decent lifestyle when you're trying to really get things done. And, you know, wood's great, but it pollutes like all get out. And alcohol is pollution-free. We use it in your house as a cooking fuel,
mm-hmm.
which is a very nice cooking fuel. It's similar to natural gas. You can make electricity with it. And with electricity, you can make hot water. In other words, the cogeneration of electricity from your generator can give you your hot water and your electricity. So alcohol is a very flexible fuel, and it never goes bad. It's like you think about people say, well, I'm going to put in 10,000 gallons of gas tanks, and so when the end of the distribution of fuel happens, I'll have all that fuel. Well, in 6 months, it's all tar and varnish, and it's no good.
Actually, it's a lot less now with the ethanol that they've been putting in. The gas is going bad in about 3 months has been the experience.
Well, actually, oil companies take gasoline back from gas stations in 30 days because the volatile parts of gasoline evaporate, and then it's no longer usable commercially. So, yes, fossil fuels don't last. You can open a bottle of gin from the Roman Empire and still drink it because alcohol never goes bad.
Wow. Well, I just want to open this possibility. There's a tremendous amount of resource in David's book, Alcohol Can Be a Gas. And if this is something that's intriguing to you or interesting to you, I'd highly recommend take a look at David's book or get in contact with David Blume. This is such a useful scenario. Regardless of whether you believe in peak oil or not, we certainly are having fuel prices increasing, and that's the trend. So this is Marjorie Wildcraft, again, with David Blume. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next segment.